The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents...
Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. How do you measure fear? It's like pain or love or hate or any of the imponderable things in life. It varies from individual to individual, but even that is not accurate. For fear, at the very least, has two constants. Fear of the known, fear of the unknown. Which is the more terrifying, blood-chilling, agonizing? You may decide that for yourself from this tale of tortuous suspense.
What are you doing?
There are preparations to be made. I can't leave you alone. If you fight me, I'm going to put you back to sleep.
No, 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 please.
Please, hush, hush,
please.
Hush, beautiful, please.
No.
Hush, you're so lovely when you sleep.
No, 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 no. Hush, no.
Our mystery drama, Sheer Terror, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Terry Keane and Larry Haynes. I'll be back shortly with Act One.
Scattered around New York in various broadcasting studios, actors and actresses live surrogate lives for their millions of viewers. The TV daytime serial, 5 days a week, is a central point in the average housewife's life. Only recently are we discovering that men share its vicarious viewers in ever-increasing numbers and identify just as strongly with the characters from this make-believe world as women are supposed to do. TV actors like Betty Campbell and Pete Hale are far less real to the viewer than the characters they play, Vicky Banks and Drake Haywood.
Who is it?
It's Pete, Betty.
Oh, come on in, Pete. I'm all changed.
Well, it's getting real dark out. Looks like it might rain, so I'm going to grab a cab. Can I drop you?
Hey, that'd be great. Jim and I are going out to dinner, so I told him to go on straight home from the precinct and change. Can you wait long enough for me to take off the false eyelashes? I hate to wear them home. They bug Jim.
Oh, no, no, I'm in no rush. How is that big lug you married, huh?
Best captain on the detective squad.
Oh, you mean he hasn't made police commissioner yet?
Well, I just give him a couple of years. How's Marge?
Want to know a secret?
She already told me last week. Congratulations, Pops.
Hey, well, maybe this time it'll be a girl, huh?
Well, if at first you don't succeed.
Yeah. But this one's number three. And how long can you keep on trying?
Hey, wait. You'll have to talk about that with Marge.
Well.
One day soon, we'll catch up.
Yeah. Hey, with the big day coming up Monday, you've got no contract to hold you back anymore.
Yeah, I wish we'd pre-taped the wedding scene this week like I asked. Jim has accumulated leave, and we could have left by today and had a whole extra weekend in the Bahamas.
Well, you can't fight the powers that be, Betty, or let down the fans. When dream girl Vicky Banks and the dashing millionaire from Philadelphia, Drake Haywood, get married up, it's got to be live in person, not a picture.
There. Darn lashes are off. I'll just put them in the box and save them for lights, camera, action on Monday. Okay, leading man, let's travel.
Okay, leading lady, but only as far as home. You don't get me on the road again. I like it too much right here in the Big Apple.
Oh, hey, make sure it's locked. Huh? I promised wardrobe I'd guard that bridal dress with my life.
Well, it's locked, it's locked. No precaution is too great to guard against any hitch about Vicky and Drake getting hitched.
Yeah, no, it's kind of scary, isn't it?
Scary?
I mean, two made-up people that you and I act out could be so important to so many real people.
Doesn't scare me. Keeps me laughing all the way to the bank. Oh, darn it.
What's wrong?
I left my wallet upstairs in the dressing room. Hey, can you wait till I run up and get it?
I'll do better than that. You go fetch it, and I'll go outside and round up a cab.
I won't be more than a minute. Hey, it's kind of dark outside. Why don't you wait for me?
Don't be silly. I'm a big girl now. Besides, like you say, one-third of a nation loves Vicky Banks, to say nothing of being married to a detective. What do I have to be afraid of?
Vicky? Vicky?
Hmm? Oh. You mean me?
Yes. Vicky, don't be afraid, Vicky. I'm not going to hurt you.
No, but you are. And that smell, that...
It's only chloroform to put you to sleep. Don't worry, my beloved, don't worry. I love you.
No,
Vicky.
No,
love
please
you.
Don't. Wait.
Don't worry, my dears. You're so small and helpless and so desirable. I can lift you into my car as easily as I can carry you across the last threshold.
Betty, I'm sorry. Betty? Where in the heck could she have gotten to? And if that was her pulling away in a cloud of dust, why the heck would she stand me up?
Hi, darling.
Oh, no, I've misjudged our friendship up to now. It's Pete, Jim.
Oh, Pete, I'm sorry. I've been expecting Betty home, so I thought it must be a call from her. You still at the studio?
No. I just got home. I had an uneasy hunch that I ought to give you a ring.
Oh, how come?
Oh, Jim. Well, Jim, I'm not trying to cry wolf or anything, but about an hour ago, when Betty and I were leaving the studio, this thing sort of happened.
What sort of thing?
Well, Betty and I were going to take a cab together, and I had to run back for my wallet. She said she'd go outside and flag down a hack and wait for me.
All right, come on, Pete. What are you trying to say?
Well, he said, that's when the whole trouble started, Jim. I mean, I don't exactly know. When I came down and went charging outside, Betty was gone.
What do you mean, gone?
Well, you know how the block is. The studio's in the middle, so you could look either way to see someone hailing a cab.
Well, not exactly. It's a one-way street.
Yeah. But I mean, if you walk either way to one of the avenues...
Now, never mind all the evasions, Pete. We're not kidding here anymore. I'd be a pretty lousy detective if I couldn't read concern in your voice. Now, what are you worried about?
I give you my word that it wasn't 2 minutes before I came downstairs from the dressing room and went outside. When I got there, Betts was gone.
The street was empty?
Well, that time of night, yeah. Except for some kid burning his tires getting away up the block.
Some kid, huh? Or maybe some guy just plain abducting my wife, Betty.
What for?
For money. Like any kidnapping. Now, you people who work in those soap operas got any idea how much any of you could be worth to a wrong guy?
Oh, Jim, now come on. You know,
right now, I don't know which way to think. Just get off my line, Pete, and let me get some pros to help check this gig out. Got Warthog.
Hey, don't call me Warthog.
All right, pardon me, Sergeant Watowski.
You, Captain Campbell. Oh, that's all right. You could call me Warthog.
I only do when I'm worried. What do you got, Sergeant?
I don't want you to get mad, Captain.
All right, what do you got?
Nothing. I mean, that sofa.
No witnesses?
No.
Nobody saw Betty come out of the studio, hail a cab?
Hails on Everest to comb in the block. Anything overlooking or any residents who might have been going and coming. I work this whole building here, and I got a list of the TV employees. As soon as I get back to the precinct, I'll get on the pipe, check them out.
All right, we'll want to check all the cab companies, see if anyone has a record of picking her up at that time.
The trouble is, it could have been an independent.
Yeah, or a gypsy.
Well, maybe it's a false alarm. Have you checked?
Yeah, I called home just before I stopped the car. Nothing. All right, come on. I want to prowl the area myself a minute or two. I got a notion in the back of my head, Sergeant. There's some lead hanging around that I'm not following up.
You awake, my darling?
Yes. Where am I?
No, where you're safe. Always and always and forever.
Who are you?
Don't you know?
Why am I tied up like this?
Because you're not ready for the truth yet. Because I can't trust you all the way till the final truth.
Please, please let me go. Untie me.
Oh, I wish I could. I wish.
Why can't you?
Well, it isn't the moment for you to understand. I have to go now.
Where?
Well, there's so many preparations to be made and so little time. If you want me to untie you, I could put you to sleep again with the chloroform.
No. I'd rather be tied.
Are you arguing with me?
I'm only telling you not to use that awful stuff again.
Don't ever say no to me, or don't.
I didn't say no, or don't. Or I didn't mean to.
Good. Now, please, you must never cross me. That's when I start to get violent. I don't mean to. It just happens. You see? Well, you didn't answer.
I didn't know how to. What is it? What do you want? Is it money?
Money?
You can have all you want. I mean, all I have.
Oh, all you have?
If I could just make a phone call. Oh,
no, Vicky, no.
Why do you keep calling me Vicky?
Yes, that is your name.
It's not my real name. My name is Betty.
Don't contradict me. I warn you. I can't stand to be contradicted.
Oh, what are you doing?
I told you. There are preparations to be made, and I can't leave you alone if you're going to fight me. Now, I'm going to have to put you back to sleep.
No, please.
Hush, my beautiful. Oh, hush, you're so lovely when you sleep.
Any luck, Captain?
No. All we have is an approximate time, 6:18 p.m. Did Everett or Kelly turn up anything?
Why, no, they're still working a block for eyewitnesses. But I did.
What?
Well, see, I figured your Betty is a nice, active little woman. Now, how easy would it be to hustle her into a cab that fast?
Are you trying to tell me she just got into a cab by herself and took off for nowhere?
Oh, no, sir.
All right, then what?
Then I found this. It's, a rag for cleaning, like my old lady calls a cheesecloth.
That's just what it is.
Only it's been soaked in something and...
It's chloroform or ether, something like that.
Yeah, you said it.
Now, where'd you find this?
Well, in a corner of those two steps from the door right out of the building. It caught my eye like somebody, threw it away in a hurry.
Yeah, right here, where Betty came out. Now, let's see, would have had a car running by the curb right where that street light is out. They take her from behind, out of the shadows, smother any cry for help, and by the time they got her in the car, she'd be out.
Sure looks like a snatch, all right. What are you going to do, Kevin?
I'm going to get back to my apartment and wait for him to make the contact. Now, you call off the boys, and everybody sit tight till you hear from me.
Call them off? Why'd you just let the department go ahead?
No, this is my wife. I'm not taking any chances on her life till I know what these guys or whoever it is want with her.
Well, I don't mean to speak out of turn, Captain, but don't you take more of a chance if you stop giving us any chance to trace her?
No.
But you always said, Captain, there's no way to trust a kidnapper. The only thing...
Maybe I'm learning a lesson. It's always been someone else before. Well, this time the victim happens to be my wife. I'm going to go home and sit by that phone.
Jim? Oh, no. My hands, I'm still tied up. Oh, if I could only get them loose. I can't. What does he want with me? Where is he? He scares me so with those flat, blank, pale blue eyes. Oh, if only it weren't so dark. There's no window. There's nothing. Why does he keep calling me Vicky? I'm afraid he's mad. If he keeps me prisoner like this before he's done with me, I think I could go mad too.
Seeds of terror are sown. What does the man with the pale blue eyes want of Betty? Or as he insists on calling her, Vicky? Is this a kidnapping of a girl named Betty Campbell? Or is it a deeper horror, an abduction by someone who lives in a fantasy world and has stolen a girl named Vicky Banks from a world as fantasized as his own. I shall return shortly with Act Two. Hours later, how many hours, she doesn't know, Betty awakens in a dark room. In the half-world between drugged sleep and the return of awareness, she lies supine on the hard bed. Then the cords tying her wrists and pulling tight across her ankles bring the terror flooding back. Her eyes are open, but her world is still dark. Helpless to move, her mind runs scattering through fright, half-memories, prayer, and what possible action she can take to escape.
I have no idea where I am. Only a vague memory of this room I'm locked into. Empty. No rug, no window. Just the door. And when he comes back through it, how can I escape? The door. Yes, wait a minute. I remember once. What? Yes, a door, I know. When I was little, and the lock to the bathroom jammed, and my father, what did he do? Something about the hinges. No, but first I have to get my hands free so I can get untied.
Yep. Oh, it's you, Sergeant.
Okay, they come in, sir.
You got any news?
No. You?
No.
You look real beat, Captain. I thought maybe I could spell you here at the phone.
Yeah, you got an idea. Let's have a cup of coffee first. I got it all brewed. You got no leads at all?
Like I told you, 7 o'clock this morning, we're still checking hackies. Zero. Witnesses, zero. Hmm. Except for your friend, Mr. Hale.
Well, Pete? No, all he saw was some car hightailing it out of there. He figured it was some wheel-crazy kid. There's nothing to go on there. Here's your coffee.
Hey, thanks.
Now, why doesn't the guy call?
What guy?
Whoever abducted her. Just let him call. He can have anything he wants, just so I get her back.
Oh, you'll get her back, Chief. We'll get her back for you. Only, Captain...
What?
How's about opening it up instead of sitting on it? Give it to the press, radio, TV. Get it in the headlines. Spread it wide enough so this guy can know what he's up against.
What do you mean, what he's up against?
That he didn't snatch no ordinary dame.
He knows that.
Oh, he could know she's a TV star like that. But does he know that she's married to a cop?
Now, what difference does that make?
You ain't thinking straight.
What, do you think a policeman has any more rights or clout than an ordinary citizen?
Maybe not where a kidnapping is concerned.
Well, then what are you talking about?
You ever stop to consider maybe this ain't no ordinary snatch?
What?
Look at the time, Captain, huh?
5:30.
Right. That means Mrs. Campbell's been gone pretty near 24 hours. Now, how come there's been no contact yet?
Well, maybe he thinks it's safer by mail.
Hey, it's a weekend coming up. He ain't gonna allow that much time to pass. And here's another thing. I don't know how much money someone like Mrs. Campbell makes in daytime TV, but it's hard to figure it's all that heavy bread.
Now, what are you getting at?
That there's two other possibilities. You must have thought of them.
You mean someone like Ferrara or Big Charney might want to get back at me because I busted them and had them sent up?
Yeah.
Well, I thought of that. I have their files pulled. They're still doing time.
Well, there were others who promised they'd get you as soon as they got out.
Yeah, I know. I'm having the precinct check them out right
you
now.
You don't have to, Captain. That's where I've been all day. I dug them all up. Mad Dog Perrine, Charlie Deadbeat, Jimmy Valdez. They're clean. At least as far as this is concerned.
So, that leaves the last possibility.
Yeah.
And that's something I don't like to face.
I don't blame you, boss. There's no way to put your finger on a kook.
You don't think this could have been a psycho?
You don't have to ask me that, Captain. You know that's what's in your mind.
But why, Betty? Why?
When it comes to psychos, count me out. You're the one with the brains, Captain.
If I face it, it doesn't take much brains. Now, Betty's highly visible in that serial. Millions of people know her. Now, what would he want with her? What would...
We gotta get a lead on this bird somehow. A picture, a description, something. If we only had a witness. You know, it's crazy. A New York street that time of night, somebody...
Now, wait a minute. The bag lady.
The what?
Remember I told you there was something in the back of my mind, something missing from the street? It was the bag lady.
You mean one of them old dames who hangs around with shopping bags and picks through trash?
Yeah, that's right. You know, every time I've picked Betty up from the studio, she's been sitting there. She hangs out in a corner under the steps between the last brownstone and the new building. They're sad old things, but they have to have some place they feel safe from whatever haunts them. It takes one heck of a jolt to uproot them. Well, I saw her the day before Betty disappeared. Why was she missing the next night?
Hey, you think she might have seen something?
Well, it's a chance.
Set a psycho to catch a psycho, huh? Hey, maybe you got something, Captain. Now, how do we find her?
Well, I'm going to have someone here to cover the phone and get out on this myself. Now, you, me, and everyone the precinct can spare are going to drag that area until we do. I only hope we can find her. And if we do, that she saw something, and if she did, she can remember what it was.
Vicky? Vicky, you asleep?
Oh.
I brought you something to eat. Here, we get some soup and some Chinese food. Do you like Chinese food? Hmm? I couldn't remember. Do you like Chinese food?
Oh,
of course. Silly of me. The gag, we must take that off. But you must promise not to scream. Please, that upsets me. I don't like to have you scream. It makes me feel... Well, it's funny because I'm very gentle. I want to be gentle, but some things make me violent. So you won't scream, will you? Oh, good. And if I do it quickly, it shouldn't hurt. I don't really want to hurt you. Oh, did that hurt? Oh. Did it? Oh.
I don't know. Everything hurts. Being tied up like this, I'm so cramped.
Oh, there. Poor darling Vicky. I'll set my little bird free for a moment here. Now, let me see. Why, you almost had your hands free. You were trying to escape.
Oh.
I don't like that. Now, why should you want to escape from me, Vicky? You know what I should do because of that. I should hurt you back.
No, I was not trying to escape. It was just that... No, the ropes hurt so. I wanted...
Oh, my poor Bill. Oh, yes. I don't want to treat you so, really.
My ankles hurt, too. Could you set... my feet free also?
Oh, yes. I want to do everything for you. You see, what you ask is easy. As easy as this. There. You see? And you see what cut them?
A straight razor.
Yes. Yes, it belonged to my father. You know, he cut my mother's throat with this. And he left me alone. I thought I was always going to be alone until... Do you want to have something to eat, huh? A nice dinner for two? Hey, well, did you like our first dinner together, Vicky?
I was hungry. And stop calling me Vicky.
Don't tell me what to do. Don't ever tell me what to do.
I'm sorry. No. It's just... It is not my real name.
But of course it is. Now, haven't I known you for nearly 3 years? I've watched you grow up and flower into a lovely woman, just like... Your name is Vicky Banks, and I love you.
But it isn't really. That's just a part I play on a show.
Do you remember when Tommy Prince was in love with you, and you were kind because he lost an arm? So kind that you might have married him if he hadn't died in that car crash?
Tommy, yes. But you see, that was just a made-up story.
I knew then that at last there was somewhere I had a chance.
What do you mean, a chance?
A chance to be loved. To be accepted. See, I knew that you were a girl who wouldn't care about what was the matter with me. That you would take me just like I am. And that's when I knew that someday we were going to be married.
that you would marry me, Sid Prout, that you would be my wife.
But, Sid, I can't marry you.
Why not?
Because I'm already married.
Oh. Oh, no, you're not. Mm-mm. You don't marry Drake Haywood till the day after tomorrow, Vicky.
Mm? Drake Haywood?
Mm-hmm.
Drake Haywood is just a made-up character like Vicky Banks. We are not real. Drake's real name is really Pete Hale. He has a wife and three children and a fourth on the way. And my real name is Betty Campbell, and I'm married to a police detective called Jim.
Lies. You are Vicky Banks, and nobody is going to have you but me. Now, it's all arranged because I arranged it. I just have to finish the preparations, and Monday, you and me will be married. Vicky Banks and Sid Prout. And then we'll consummate our marriage. Oh, but it will be beautiful, Vicky, and not sordid and hateful like my father and my mother, because you and I, we will find perfect peace together forever.
What are you talking about?
This. The razor is so sharp you will never feel a thing, and I shall follow immediately.
You're mad.
No, don't say that to me. Come, Vicky. Come to me.
No, don't touch me. Don't touch me. I'll scream.
Well, you know that won't do any good. There's nobody to hear you.
How do I know that?
Because I tell you it's so.
Then why won't you believe what I try to tell you? Sid. Please, Sid, listen to me. We can't be married because I'm already going to have a child.
Oh, that's a lie.
It's the truth.
No, you can't be having a child. Vicky, everybody knows how sensitive and how fastidious you were, and that's what put men off. But it drew me to you because it was just how my mother was. Oh, to find a woman like her. Oh, Vicky, we were made for each other.
No, stay away from me, please. Don't touch me.
I understand, my dear. You're right. When we meet together, it must be pure and perfect. Oh, it's late. It's 8:00. Now you must rest.
No. Please, not the chloroform again, and please don't gag and tie me.
But don't you see, I must. The rest of the world doesn't understand. And we must celebrate our wedding alone.
Oh. Hi, Jim.
Pete, no calls?
No, nothing except the precinct and,
And what?
Well, a couple of reporters. They seem to have gotten wind that something's up.
Oh, brother, that's all we need.
You haven't turned up anything?
No. What kind of a detective am I? Can't even find my own wife. She's in terrible danger, Pete. I know it. I can sense it. Now, what am I going to do? What am I going to do?
What feeling in the world is more desperate than frustration? Especially when it is linked with fear or concern for someone's safety. And that Betty Calder is in danger, ultimate and complete, there can be no doubt. I shall return shortly with Act 3. I suggested at the beginning of this tale the subject, fear of the unknown, I didn't mean to mislead you. I meant the special terror, the thinking of a twisted mind that defies any rationale. The situation Betty is facing, alone and convinced that time is running out. She can only rely on herself to escape death. She is awakened now in the dark prison of her room, with no idea if it is day or night. For an interminable period of time, she has lain listening, trying to determine if she is alone. At last, she has decided she is, and decides to use her last weapon, for she has not been gagged.
Help! Help! Can anyone hear me? Help me! Help me! If you can hear me,
Now, no one can hear you in this loft building. We are the only tenants. But because you don't have faith in me, I should...
No, Sid, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I didn't mean anything. It's only that, please, I woke up, you see, in the dark, and I was all bound like this from a terrible dream, and I was scared and alone, and I was so afraid.
Yes, of course you were, Vicky. Dear, oh, I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. I know how terrible this is for you, but I don't want to have you tied. It's only that... Oh, I just can't lose you. Not now, when we're so close to the moment of truth.
Then can I be untied?
Well, now. Now you can.
Now? You're going to let me go?
Let you go? No, never. But now, now I don't have to worry about losing you.
Why?
Because I have a guardian angel for you. Michael? Meet Vicky. No, boy. No, friend.
What is he?
Well, it's hard to say exactly. He's part Alsatian, part Doberman, I guess. I borrowed him from the kennel to make him happy.
It sounds dangerous.
No, shh. Not unless anyone goes against what he's being taught. Oh, he's beautifully trained. Look. Sit. Lie. Stay.
He's your dog?
Oh, no. Like I say, I borrowed him. I don't want to keep you tied up, Vicky, but I still have so many things to do before it all happens for us. So I brought him to guard you.
To guard me?
Yes, he's really very friendly. He is an attack dog, but unless someone is threatened, he's a nice boy. Aren't you, Mike, huh?
He seems quite gentle.
Yes, that's his nature. But don't be fooled. He's been trained to be a killer. Here, let me have the pillow.
What for?
Here, I'll show you. Here. Now, here, boy, here. Attack!
Okay, no. Freeze! Good boy. Good fellow.
Tore that pillow apart.
Yes, or anything else he was ordered to attack. You see, that's training.
You seem to know a lot about dogs.
Well, I should. It's been my profession.
Been?
Yes. See, come Monday, you and I start a new life, married in the true faith and dedicated to eternal life together beyond the curtain.
Please let me talk to you.
No, I'm sorry, not now. I must go to work for the last day, and then there are so many things still to get ready for tomorrow.
You're going to tie me up again?
No. There's no need with Michael here. But he'll be your guardian. I will be back tonight to say my last goodbye. Then we will join the long sleep together. Don't try to run from me, or Michael will stop you. I'm leaving him on guard outside the door. Now, he's better than any lock. Now, for your safety, my darling, I warn you not to try to leave.
Captain Campbell, 83rd Precinct.
It's the old warthog, Captain. I think we got your bag, lady.
Where are you?
On the south side of the Bible Building, just off Broadway to the west.
Okay, I'll be right there.
Great, and, Captain?
Yeah, what?
Why don't you bring us all some coffee, huh? Amanda likes hers half and half.
Hello, Sergeant.
Captain, now this here is Miss Amanda Schutz.
What are you on, ferries, tugs, Hudson River Line?
I told you, Amanda. He's a cop, just like me.
Another one. I don't like cops.
We only want to ask you some questions, Miss Schutz.
That's why I don't like you guys. And don't call me Miss Schutz.
Isn't that your name?
It is. Just say Amanda.
All right, Amanda. I need your help.
Then do I get left alone?
I hope so. Well, first off, I brought us all some coffee.
Got any half and half?
Yeah, I sure do. Like Sergeant Wartowski told me.
In that case, maybe I'll answer. Give me the coffee first.
Okay, here you are, madam.
Miss.
I'm sorry, miss. You are what?
Oh, thanks, boss.
Hey, that's good, Java. Now, what else can I tell you? I ain't already told this lug.
What did she tell you, what?
Yeah, she was right, boss. She seen this guy drive up and park. She seen him there before, hanging around. She saw the missus come out Friday night, and this guy hustles her into the wagon and took off.
Did you get the license plate number?
I don't see good. I got glasses, but they're not my prescription. I found them in a trash can.
All right, what kind of car was it?
The best she remembers is it was a station wagon.
A station wagon, that's just great.
Well, there's something more. She said that it had bars, like, in the back.
Bars? What kind of bars?
Like you got in some patrol cars. That's why I took off. I got enough trouble with cops.
Now, what about the man who hustled my wife into the car? Was there anything special about him?
Like I said, I don't see so good. Yeah, that is good coffee. Oh. Yeah, he had a limp, like, with one of them shoes all built up like a... What do you call it?
Clubfoot?
Yeah, I guess. Hey, you got any more Java?
Wharton.
Yeah, Captain.
I think maybe the balloon just went up.
What do you mean?
A station wagon with bars, like you put up for a dog, huh? Chloroform. Now, that's not so easy to get hold of unless you work around a clinic or a lab. So, how about a vet?
Well, I don't get you.
A veterinarian. Now, he'd have it right on the shelf, and he'd have a car like that, too. Get the gas and turn on the squealer.
Sure. Where to, Cap?
The precinct house. Round up a dragnet. We're going to cover every vet in this city.
Sid Prout.
Yes, Dr. Montrose.
I just came up from the kennels. There's a dog missing.
A dog?
When you hear me, what kind of an idiot are you? They're our stock in trade, aren't they? The Stewart's dog, the one that Prowler knifed. He's not in his run.
He's not?
Are you listening to me? Now, that's a valuable dog that Joe Stewart invested a long time training, and he'll be here tomorrow to pick him up. What happened to him?
Oh, excuse me, Dr. Montrose. I've got to go. I have an appointment.
Well, wait a minute, you clumsy idiot. I'm talking to you. Sid, you come back here. I want to know... Oh, now, who in heaven's name could that be on a Sunday afternoon? Yes?
Captain Campbell and Sergeant Wartofsky, 83rd Precinct. Here's our IDs.
Oh, all right. What do you want? It ain't him, Captain. He walks all right.
All right, just a minute. Do you own a station wagon with bars or wire netting in the back, Dr. Montrose?
Yes.
Does anyone else drive it but you?
Matter of fact, I very seldom drive it. My assistant does that.
Your assistant?
Well, that's rather a grandiose title. Sid Prout feeds the dogs, delivers them sometimes, or picks up strays.
Does this assistant of yours have a club foot?
Yes, he does.
I want to talk to him.
Oh, very well. If he's still here, he went down towards the kennel. Well, that's my car now. And that's Sid driving. I don't know what he's
doing. Come on, Ward, follow him. And don't you lose him, or so help me, I'll break your neck.
If I wait any longer, he'll be back. I've got to take the chance. It's now or never. I've never been afraid of dogs before. Yes. That's the secret. I mustn't let him know I'm afraid of him. Okay, Betty. If you ever thought you were an actress, this had better be your best performance. Hey, Mike, it's all right. Nothing to worry about. Come on, you and I are just going to take a nice little walk. Yeah, see? That's a good boy. Come on. You want to take me for a walk? Heel, boy. Heel. Oh, God, thank you. Maybe I'm going to make it. All right, fella? Huh? Friends? Let's you and me get out of here. Sid, what down the razor.
Oh, no. No, somehow you betrayed us. You sent the police on us, Vicky, and we can't be married anymore.
Then I didn't.
No,
I
lied
did not.
You lied. You spoiled it all. I had it arranged, your wedding dress. I read your size in a magazine, and it was all finished for me to pick up tonight. It was going to be so beautiful, but you spoiled it.
Keep away from me.
No, never. It's too late for us to be married, Vicky, but we can still be together. One quick stroke across your throat, my beloved, and then a second across mine, and I'll follow you, and we're together for all eternity.
No, no, Seth.
There is no way you can stop me.
No.
Oh, Vicky.
Michael, if you are my guardian angel, attack.
No,
attack.
No,
attack.
No, no, no. No, let go. Let down, boy. Down.
Okay, sound free.
No, you don't have to worry. You don't have to worry. Mike's taking care of him. Oh, Jim. Jim, I've been so scared.
All right, all right. It's over, darling. It's all over.
What I'll never quite understand, Jim, is about the dog.
Yeah. It's what Sid Prout didn't understand either. See, Mike wasn't an attack dog. He was a guard dog. Now, his training taught him to attack only when someone was threatened.
So he really was my guardian angel.
Yeah, well, only for one time around, darling. But from now on, I'm taking the job full time, and I promise you, you'll never be threatened again.
And as Betty Campbell, she has never been threatened again. Of course, as Vicky Banks, if you follow that particular story, even after her happy marriage to Drake, the catalog of disaster that Vicky has gone through would make Job look like a piker. But that's storyland, and never to be confused with real life, or after what has happened, what is. I'll be back shortly. Shakespeare said, "Tell me, where is fancy bred, or in the heart, or in the head? What wild fancies swarmed in Sid Prout's tortured brain, and how fortunate that in this case, no one was the victim. Let's not even speculate that someone else, sometime, somewhere, might be the victim of a deranged brain. Take no more thought unto tomorrow. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." Our cast included Terry Keane, Larry Haynes, Ian Martin, and Earl Hammond. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
Why are we doing this?
I told you, to make $1 million, maybe more.
I don't see it. Oh, yes, I can get him to spend some money on me, but nowhere near $1 million. And where do you come in?
Don't worry about a thing.
Blackmail? You think he'd come up with $1 million just to keep his wife from finding out? I don't.
I told you. Don't worry about it.
Or do you think the scandal would ruin him with his old-time conservative blue-chip customers?
You're not even warm, Willie.
Oh, yes, I am. I'm warm, vibrant, vital, alive. I am quoting Mr. Harrison Dillard Wentworth, also known as Dilly.
Yeah, will you just keep heating up, Mr. Harrison Dillard Wentworth, and I'll let you know when to take him out of the oven.
Oh, why can't you tell me what the angle is?
Isn't it better this way? All you have to do is concentrate on the job at hand.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.